Welcome to this afternoon's Carolyn and Edward Jr. Wenk Lecture on Technology and Public Policy. The Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering is delighted to have with us today Secretary Stephen Chu, coming to us from Stanford University. We are looking forward to a great lecture on climate change and the low-cost path to clean energy. Just to give you an overview of what will happen, after my opening introductions, I will hand the stage over to the Benjamin T. Rowe Dean of the Whiting School of Engineering, Professor Ed Schlesinger, who will tell us a little bit about the Wenk Lecture Series. After that, we will have Professor Julian Krolik tell us some additional information that's not written in the pamphlet about his friend, Professor Chu. And then after that, Professor Chu will come up and give the lecture, and then at the end, we'll have a closing, small closing remarks. And then from there, we will move over to the Levering complex where we will have reception. Okay, so without any further ado, please.
Thank you, Ralph. Good afternoon. My name is Ed Schlesinger, and I'm the Benjamin T. Rome Dean of the Whiting School of Engineering. And first, I'd like to welcome all of our guests here today, in addition to our keynote speaker, from whom you will hear shortly. It is my pleasure to share with you today some background on the late Carolyn and Edward Wenk. Dr. Wenk earned a B.E. in civil engineering from Hopkins in 1940, an M.S. in applied mathematics from Harvard in 1947, and his D.Eng. in civil engineering from Hopkins in 1950. In 1959, as Congress's first science and technology advisor, his thinking led to the creation of Congress's Office of Technology Assessment. Later, President Kennedy made him an assistant to his science advisor and executive secretary of the Federal Council on Science and Technology. Dr. Wenk played a major role in the establishment of the Office of Science and Technology Policy. Dr. Wenk continued his service when Presidents Johnson and Nixon appointed him Executive Secretary of the President's Cabinet-level Council on Marine Resources and Engineering Development. In 1970, Dr. Wenk became part of the faculty of the University of Washington. For 6 years, he directed the university's program in social management of technology, where he supervised research in important environmental subjects. After the tragic oil spill from the Exxon Valdez, the governor of Alaska appointed Dr. Wenk to a commission investigating the cause of the accident, the effects of the spill, and to identify steps to lower future risks of another accident. Dr. Wenk received an honorary degree from Johns Hopkins University in 1989. Part of his citation read, "A humanitarian with a clear and unwavering dedication to preserving human dignity, equality, and freedom in this age of dizzying technological change." Our event today also honors Carolyn Wenk for her contributions to humanitarian causes. Mrs. Wenk was a dedicated volunteer in hospitals and mental health facilities and volunteered to aid the homeless. After the Wenks moved to the Northwest, she became skilled in watercolor, and her work was featured in several shows. Regrettably, Mrs. Wenk passed away in October 2004, and Mr. Wenk passed away in June of 2012. Carolyn and Edward Wenk have made significant contributions to impact humanitarian and environmental causes, and I'm grateful to use this opportunity to honor them both. And with that, it's my pleasure to invite Professor Julian H. Krolik from the Johns Hopkins University Department of Physics and Astronomy to the podium to formally introduce our keynote speaker.
It's a particular pleasure, both professionally and personally, to welcome Steve Chu to Johns Hopkins today for the 2016 Wenk Lecture on Public Policy and Technology. I'm here, I think, for the light entertainment, as Steve and I have known each other for more years than I think either one of us would like to admit. But I'll try to avoid the good stuff. It's Now, Steve has had a long and distinguished career, putting his mark on diverse fields of endeavor, from basic research in atomic physics, quantum electronics, and polymer behavior in biological systems, to the highest levels of intersection between science, technology, and government. He earned his PhD in physics from the University of California, Berkeley, for an experiment that measured the effect of weak nuclear forces on atomic energy levels. I have to say that his reputation as a scientist began to grow even well before he finished his thesis. Even while still a graduate student, he was already known within the department as a master at making laboratory devices sing, and also for his athletic prowess, which was displayed frequently on the tennis court and the ball field. From Berkeley, he moved to Bell Labs, where he spent the next 10 years. Bell Labs was then a major center for many areas of physics, and it was there that he developed the laser cooling method for drastically reducing the temperature of a gas of atoms. Laser cooling opened wide the door to an extremely broad range of high-precision measurements, because this technique made it possible to hold individual atoms in place for extremely long times. He's received many, many awards for this research, many too many to list here. I will mention, however, the 1997 Nobel Prize in Physics, which he shared with Claude Cohen-Tanucci and Bill Phillips for developing laser cooling. From 1987 to 2004, he was professor of physics at Stanford, and for a number of years was its department chair. He left Stanford in 2004 to return to Berkeley, where he then became director of the Lawrence Berkeley Lab. Although LBL was founded by Ernest Lawrence to build the first cyclotrons, and concentrated on nuclear and particle physics for many years thereafter, Steve led a major change in its direction, substantially augmenting its programs in alternative energy sources and energy policy. This effort led to his appointment as Secretary of Energy by President Obama, a post he held for the entirety of the first term of the Obama administration. Among his many achievements in that position was to oversee a very significant increase in investment in renewable energy research and technology, including notably the launch of ARPA-E, an energy analog to the famous Advanced Research Projects Agency of the Defense Department. Since leaving Washington, he has been back at Stanford, this time as professor of molecular and cellular physiology in the medical school, as well as professor of physics. But he has continued to think about how we can build a society rich in energy to support human activity, but without harmful environmental effects. And this is, of course, the subject of his lecture today, climate change and a low-cost path to clean energy, which we all look forward to hearing. Professor Chu.
So thank you, Julian, for the lovely introduction, and thank you all for willing to come out and hear me give a talk on this subject. So this is something I started into and started caring about as an amateur. I was a scientist and was in the late 1990s to 2000, became increasingly concerned that maybe what if these climate scientists are right and maybe there are some risks, began to read about it, think about it, and started to put into my talks discussions about what might happen. So I'm here to update you on what we now know. It's mostly not good news, but also to try to show you that there is a path forward. All right, so the outline of the talk is I'm going to talk about the risk of climate change, focusing on some recent data, but then turn to how science and technology can really offer some solutions. So here's the risk of climate change. Many of you have seen this. This is an average land and sea surface temperature of the globe from about 1880 to 2015. And over here you have that the in this period of time, the average temperature went up about 1 degree centigrade, 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, when I was in DC from the beginning of January 2009 till the end of April 2013, I heard a lot of people talk about the fact that the climate wasn't changing, and what they would say is, see, in the last decade or 12 years, the temperature hasn't increased. And they had, and they said climate scientists did not predict this plateau in temperature. This was before the last 2 years and this year 16, but never mind that. There was, in fact, a slight plateauing of the rise in temperature, and it was not predicted by climate models. Why not? Well, this is a picture of the BP oil spill, and that happened April 20th, 2010. And during a cabinet meeting in early May, the president went up to me after the meeting. He had heard I made a suggestion to BP engineers about something. And he said, "Chu, go down there and help them stop the leak." "Yes, sir." So I called up a few out-of-the-box thinkers, and I said, "You know, I don't know anything about oil, leaks and oil recovery and things like that, but let's try to see if we can help BP stop the leak." Why am I showing you this picture? This is 1 mile deep where oil was leaking out, and the surface temperature of the Gulf of Mexico during the summer of 2010 was about 30 degrees centigrade, a very bathtub warm temperature, but the temperature 1 mile deep was 1 degree centigrade above freezing, remains that year all year round. So 1 mile deep, the oceans are cold, and it takes a long time to warm up the oceans, 2 miles deep even longer. And so in measuring surface temperatures of land and ocean, we weren't measuring the depths of the ocean. But we started doing that, and the world started dropping these so-called Argo floats into the water. They would take the temperature of the ocean, salinity, and they would go down to depths, this generation, 2 kilometers deep. They would take temperature measurements. They'd bop up to the surface every 10 or so days, radio transmit their data, and then do it again, continuing this for about 4 years until the batteries ran out. They weren't tethered anywhere. They were just floating around. And of course, you could be skeptical and say, what's a couple of floats in the ocean to tell you what the mean depth of the ocean temperature was? And that would be a fair criticism, but there were many of them. So there were roughly 4,000 of these floats around the world, bobbing up and down. And taking measurements. And so more recently, in 2015, the results of that data were announced. And this is now taking into account not only the surface temperature, which is then part of the calibration, but also going down and measuring that. Because the oceans are not evenly distributed, more ocean in the southern hemisphere than the northern hemisphere, ocean temperatures are seasonal. And so the light gray line you see summer, winter over this period of time. And the dashed lines and the monthly trends are very good news indeed, because much to our delight, energy is conserved. What do I mean by that? To a scientist, it was an energy conservation issue. We use satellite to measure how much energy is hitting the Earth in the upper atmosphere, in the visible, in the infrared, the microwaves, ionized radiation, sunspots. We measure it all. We can make some aggregate measurement of cloud cover, things like that, to change the reflectivity. We know that there is a greenhouse gas effect, and then infrared radiation due to carbon dioxide, water vapor, and many other gases is trapping the heat. So heat going in, average over 11-year solar cycles, the same. Heat going out, less. But if the temperature plateaus, where's the energy going? It's going into the ocean. That meant that the climate models were not accurately predicting subtle changes in surface deep ocean mixing, and there was more of the mixing during that period of time. So the energy ended up in the ocean. It's okay, mystery solved, that's good. Again, you know, physicists were right. Let's turn to something else. Are glaciers melting? Is the sea level rising? And there's a short answer to that, it's yes. Now, you can go and take anecdotal evidence. This is Muir Glacier, Alaska, August 1941 and August 2004, and they look different. And so you say, at least this glacier has melted. But how do you account for all the glaciers around the world, not trying to cherry pick the ones that melted back the most, but what was really happening? And so here again, satellite data provides our best information. This is a pair of satellites called GRACE, which stands for Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. they orbit the Earth, and as the local gravity changes, it perturbs their orbits. And so by measuring the distance between these two satellites and how their orbit wobbles also with GPS, you can back calculate how changes in the acceleration due to gravity work. There's something else. In this cartoon, you see these two satellites whose distance between them is measured to a small fraction of the width of a human hair, going over Greenland. But if the ice in Greenland is melting, the rock is somewhat elastic, so it rebounds. And so again, that is a factor in the change in the acceleration due to gravity. That was realized after GRACE was launched. And so they launched other satellites, including this one, which measures very precisely change in the local altitude of lands and oceans. And so you need the combination of those two things. So there was a surprise, a big surprise. And measurements between 2002 and 2009, they measured perturbations due to gravity and land rebound effects in Antarctica. And in year 2000, it was expected that Antarctica would increase its amount of ice mass due to the fact that Antarctica is very cold, there's more precipitation, therefore there should be a more accumulation of snow and ice. Greenland a little warmer, it could be melting faster, and there was a decrease in Greenland for sure by the year 2000, we measured that. So the surprise was Antarctica was losing ice, especially in the blue section of Western Antarctica. All right, how fast it was losing ice? Well, they got the sign wrong. The little shades of yellow were slight gains, but in the last half of this data record, they went from gains to actually plateaus. If you look back in history and the last interglacial period, 129 to 116,000 years ago, the world is about 1 degree centigrade warmer than we are today, or 2 degrees warmer than before the Industrial Revolution. And you ask the question, where was the sea level then? How do you measure sea level that long ago? And it's measured by looking at the fossil record of the seashell critters that live in the border between land and ocean, which can be radioactively dated. And so where you see where they are, you can make a determination, average it around the globe, because it's not uniform, what the sea level was doing. And what we knew, and we've known this for a decade, was that in that period of time, the sea level was 6 to 9 meters higher than it is today. Okay, let me say that again. 1 degree warmer than where we are today, the equilibrium temperature 100,000 years ago, roughly, was 6 to 9 meters higher. Okay? Now, let's give you a little bit more of the record. On the extreme right-hand side on the bottom is a proxy for temperature, amount of oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 that is being used. These are Antarctica ice sheets. It goes back 800,000 years. And this is the period of time I'm talking about. In between there was an ice age. And so this is what we have. The green is methane. The maroon is carbon dioxide. And we're at 400 parts per million carbon dioxide, 430 parts per million carbon dioxide equivalent. And in methane, we're off the scale in this chart. We're actually off the scale of carbon dioxide until we go back 3 million years. And we're not going to stop at 400 parts per million or 500, and I'll get a little bit more to that later. But so the historical record says that we're not going in a good place. When the Antarctica measurements were coming out, the climate modelers began to scramble. And so this is, I forgot to put this on, never mind. Anyway, so this is a paper 2016, which began to constrain the models to account for the historical record, woken up by the fact that of Antarctica also melting. And depending on which emission scenario, this goes out to the year 2100, there are various emission scenarios, and it's somewhere between a meter rise in sea level to a fraction of a meter in this century by 2100. So alarming, but not panicking. this is what happens after 2100, depending on which scenario you choose. And the dashed lines are ones that I'm just blindly guessing as to what may likely happen. Even if we fulfill all of the UN agreements, that will put us on this dashed line and not below that. And you see now that by 2400, 2500, we're talking 5 meters, 10 meters, maybe 15 meters. But it's a long time. And when I tell some of my friends, hey, this is going to be really bad 400 or 500 years from today, or they say, not to worry, that's not my problem. A surprising number of people might think that, won't say that, but a surprising number of people actually say that. All right, we'll revisit that in a moment, but I want to pose upon you, how do we know this carbon dioxide is actually due to humans? I showed you this record where there's ice ages and warm periods and ice ages and warm periods, and I can assure you that humans had nothing to do with those previous climate changes. And the fact that they're very closely correlated with carbon dioxide and methane. So if you looked at that and said, why do we assume it's due to humans this time when it wasn't due to humans all those other times? And just as a show of hands, I'm not going to call on you, but how many people actually know the real reason? Okay. Now, this is the most compelling reason. And it's just not my opinion. It's actually stated in a recent publication of the National Academy of Sciences joint with the Royal Society. And it's something when I was Secretary of Energy, I called up Ralph Cicerone, a friend of mine, and said, why aren't they telling about this data? And they said, well, but because people don't understand isotopes. Or the climate scientists don't understand as well. So I'm going to explain to you in the next 5 minutes about carbon dating. Carbon dating, as you may know, is used to date how old things are. But how does it really work? How do you know that the Shroud of Turin wasn't really in Jesus' time, that it was maybe in some medieval time? So this is how it works. Radioactive carbon-14 is made in the upper atmosphere by cosmic ray bombardment. It's a proton reaction on nitrogen, makes carbon-14. Once carbon-14 is made, it acts like a little clock. For a certain probability of decaying, and the half-life of that decay is 5,700 years. In the meantime, this carbon-14 is drifting down from the upper atmosphere, being incorporated, as carbon does, into all living things. It gets incorporated in other things, into rocks, it gets incorporated in everything. When you die, you right now have carbon-14 in you. When you die, you have carbon-14 in you. And all the little clocks, you've got some equilibrium concentration of carbon-14 in you. And just pretend they put you away in a mausoleum that's very well sealed. And for the next 100,000 years, a million years, you don't communicate with the outside environment. Lifetime, 5,700 years, many, many lifetimes. You have no more carbon-14 in you, but you've been sealed from the environment. We take you out. We put you into a fossil fuel plant, and we use you to generate electricity. There are lots of people that have to add to this and other former organic matter. And when you put all that carbon back into the atmosphere, you're introducing carbon-12, not carbon-14. And so if there's a significant amount of carbon-14 being put in the atmosphere, you dilute the ratio of carbon-14. The essential thing is the clock starts when it gets isolated from the environment. Before that, you can't say much about the relative abundance of carbon-14 in the atmosphere and the thing. But if you see changes in what would assume to be steady state in the sense that carbon-14 is made, it diffuses in, it's incorporated into life, life dies, decays, microbes turn it back into methane or carbon dioxide, and just cycles around. 5,000 years is a long time, so there's an equilibrium. So here is a map, a graph rather, of CO2 in the atmosphere from 1750 to a little bit past year 2000. And that map, rising map, let's see if this pointer works. Yes, this is the rise in carbon dioxide direct measurements. And this is carbon-14 declining. And I'm going to show you data past 1950. This is carbon-13. There's a similar story to that, but I don't have time to tell you about that. But let me continue with carbon-14. The reason I'm not showing you beyond 1950 is because we go onto a different scale. This is now 1950, 1960, 2000. Amount of carbon dioxide shoots way up. Carbon-14, rather, shoots way up. And this is the northern hemisphere. There's a little delay, southern hemisphere. And it just goes out through the roof. I won't keep the mystery long. This is due to H-bomb testing by the United States and the Soviet Union. When you set off H-bombs into the stratosphere, you make lots of carbon-14. That carbon-14 gets absorbed by the ocean, first in the northern hemisphere, then the southern hemisphere. All the H-bomb testing was in the northern hemisphere. And then it becomes and it's diluted and goes down, down, down. And then the question is this dilution due to the atmosphere-ocean mixing, and then that's it? Or is there something else? And the answer is there's something else. This is going down at a rate that's too much for just ocean mixing. In fact, it's numerically equal within errors. The errors are roughly 25%. This is the amount of carbon dioxide we put up in the atmosphere minus the amount that gets quickly absorbed by the ocean and land. Okay, so the bookkeeping also makes sense. It's going down too fast because we're putting enough fossil fuel up into the atmosphere to dilute the amount of carbon-14 to carbon-12 ratio. This is the most compelling reason why we think it's human. If it was natural, it's doing cycling, land, oceans, and atmosphere, and natural cycles having to do with biological and geological processes, not being sequestered for millions of years and then resurfacing. And so this is the most compelling reason. Now, I talked about sea level. In case you're wondering, about one-tenth of the world population lives within 10 meters of the sea level. So if you think 4 million refugees is causing the world, and especially Europe, a problem, think of 700 million refugees. That's a bigger problem. So 4 million, 700 million. Okay, the scale is a lot more. But long before that becomes a problem, in this century, we still only project it's going to be up by a meter or so. There's going to be other things. And in the United States, as this is my personal prediction, I think the most important issue would be that temperature and rainfall patterns will change. And that, for example, in this California and the Rockies, we'll have spring rains instead of spring snows. In California, much of our water supply, a vast majority of it, comes from sierras and dams, hydroelectric dams and water storage dams that store that mountain water to be released all year round. And if there are spring rains, the water goes simply over the dams. We can't contain it. The reservoirs are not big enough. People looked into increasing the height of the dams, but that was quickly blocked by conservationists who said, no, dams are bad and bigger dams are worse. And so we are not allowed to increase the height of dams, even if it were technologically possible, which I think it is. It's just forbidden to make a bigger reservoir. So that means the reservoirs stay the same. But on the other hand, we expect hotter spring and summer weather. And so what that means is that we expect same size dams, less snow, hotter summers, more irrigation. So the water shortage issue will become a significant issue, except this is not a prediction. It has become a significant and perennial issue over decades in the Midwest and in California. And right now, over decades, you know, weather is years, climate is decades. Over the last couple of decades, farmers have had to drill deeper wells. As you go deeper, chances of getting brackish water, salty water, is becoming an issue. And in, for example, in Texas, it's become so much of an issue that the Texas government legislature has passed a rule, if you're a farmer, you own your land, you are limited in how much water you can draw from your well. This is in Texas, where the government is telling a farmer what they can't do on their own land. That's how profound an effect this is. And so, but it's going to get worse, not better. And the amounts of boron I learned, I gave a talk at Texas A&M, and I learned that 10 parts per million boron kills crops. And they're beginning to get into this situation. So you have to extract boron out of the water. Weather patterns are seemingly get worse. This is on the upper left-hand side is a picture of a town near Baton Rouge. There, Louisiana, southern Louisiana, got some very bad rains over the last couple of weeks. And that's in East Texas, other set of bad rains. This is a map of, so this is map of the United States. This is Louisiana. And what you see here in the red is this. And this is a contour map of where the rains fell. And where you see white, according to the National Weather Service estimate, that was a 1-in-1,000-year event. And where you see red, it's a 1-in-100-year event of rainfall. Now, I'm a scientist, and I said to myself, oh, yeah? Let's see, you had rainfall records for 50, 80 years. 1-in-1,000-year event? Where'd that come from? And now, as engineers, as I hope many of you are or would be engineers, those are the questions you should ask yourself. Where did that come from? This is where I think it came from. I did not call someone in the Weather Service, but this is where I think it came from. You look at rainfall patterns, you have good statistics when you go out one sigma in a distribution. And within one sigma, a lot of distributions look Gaussian. But then you take that and you say, oh, it's dropping off, the likelihood of rain is dropping off like e to the minus x squared over sigma squared with the right normalization constants, and that's great. So a 1-in-1,000-year event is 3.1 sigma. That's all it is. So based on your body of the distribution, you can easily extrapolate to get 1-in-1,000 years. The question is that correct? And the answer is no. The tail of a distribution is not Gaussian in terms of rainfall. How do I know this? Because for the last 2 years, I've been working with a mathematician slash statistician at Stanford with his graduate student, and we're trying to model the tails of the distribution. And if you go past one event every 30 years, you find empirically, there's no theorem that tells you this, is that for temperature, for example, it's dropping off as e to the minus rainfall, or temperature t to the minus sigma, instead of t squared over sigma squared. And so we began to look at this tail of the distribution, divide the United States into, use the standard way of dividing the United States into climate zones, and try to figure out using this very big data set, but does only extends from 1979 to 2015. Detailed 1 petabyte data set, but we don't have 300 year records. And so the first thing is we looked at temperature excursions. On average over this period of time, you have a 1-in-100-year event somewhere in the United States in one of these zones, and there was actually subzones. But what about different areas? Are the temperature excursions in the Rocky Mountains the same as the temperature excursions in New Mexico or in Maine? And of course, they're not. Rocky Mountains in Maine are colder than New Mexico. But you don't ask that question. You ask, in the event of anything rarer than once every 30 years, what is the distribution falling down like? Is it a single exponential? Is it something else? And remarkably, what we find, and empirical data plotted on the y-axis and temperature difference on the x-axis. Once you say I'm looking past 1-in-30 years and I begin to map different geological zones with very different weather patterns, they seem to fall on the same exponential curve with the same exponential rate. Happy accident, something like that, I don't know. You know, I'm not going to ask a climate modeler to predict that because they get a lot of other stuff wrong. This is just plain statistics and data. So let's learn to live with it and take the gift. That means all the weather temperature measurements in continental United States could be aggregated. Once you aggregate all the data from all these different zones, you get a huge data set. So even though it's less than 40 years of data, you can actually say something about 1 in 100-year events, 1 in 30-year events. The preliminary answer, we're rewriting the paper because I'm fussy, but the preliminary data is that what used to be 1 in 100-year events average over this time period, or at the beginning of the time period, is probably 1 in 20-year events, 1 in 25-year events. But most of the increase has been over the last decade and a half. So it's, again, it's going upward. We didn't assume a function for how it went upward. We let the big data analysis tell us what the functions would be. Okay, and we verified that it's a single tail exponential. All right, so the weather's getting worse in terms of hot temperatures and downpours. These are climate scenarios. This is an IPCC from 1980 up to the present time, 2015, and going to 2100. And these colors are various emission scenarios. There's lots of people who work on emission scenarios. So all that fine hair and fizz and lines are people saying, oh, it could be this, it could be that. Well, of course, we don't know what it's really going to be because that's the future. And as Yogi Berra famously said, predictions are hard to make, especially about the future. But it's going to be somewhere. I will make a prediction that's easier to predict. The lowest one, RCP 2.6. We've exceeded so much, we're not going to get there. And you notice by 2070 or so, it goes negative. That means the carbon dioxide, greenhouse gas emissions are going negative. And the only way it goes negative is we do some engineering on the globe to make it net absorbing, okay? So when you see zero, that means that there is no more carbon emissions from any sort of burning of fossil fuel for electricity, for transportation, cement, steel, you name it, nothing. Agriculture, which is 30% of our greenhouse gas emissions, nothing. Zero means nothing. No agriculture, no steel, no cement, no energy, no fossil energy. Okay? So the challenge is pretty significant. Once you stick carbon dioxide in the air, how long does it stay there? Well, there's actually turns out to be three timescales. The very, very fast timescale, in the order of a decade or so, is there's immediate uptake to 2 decades of the land and the oceans. Carbon dioxide is directly absorbed inorganically to make bicarbonates. So it's, you know, fizzy water, soda water is slightly acidic. So that's what the ocean does. The land picks it up because there's more vegetation, more CO2, so the land picks that up. And that time constant's very quick. That's of scale 10, 15 years. So that's already folded into what we're seeing today. Then there's ocean invasion, meaning that a surface water, deep water mixing. There's also little critters making carbonaceous shells. This is reaction with calcium carbonates and then mineralizing. And they have different time scales. One is 400 years, one's a few thousand years. And so roughly 40% of the carbon dioxide emitted into the atmosphere has time constants on the scale 400 to 4,000 years. And the rest is immediately taken up. So it doesn't make sense to plot emission on a per yearly basis because once it's up there, 40% of it is up there for 400 to 4,000 plus years. So you have to think of it as once it up there is integrated, minus the short-term stuff, which is already accounted for, it gets integrated up. So the way to plot carbon emission is not per year, but cumulative carbon emission. And so I took the emissions and plotted it per cumulative emissions from beginning of the Industrial Revolution to present time. And this dashed line over here, 2,900 gigatons of carbon dioxide equivalent, is the amount to have a two-thirds chance of staying below 2 degrees. Now, you'll notice a few things. First, there's an old Chinese saying that says, if you don't change direction, you will end up where you're heading. There's a lot of truth to that. The other thing you should notice is 3/4 of the greenhouse gas emissions occurred in the last 65 years. 3/4 of the greenhouse emissions since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. And guess what? The derivative is positive. The second derivative may not be positive because China's economy is slowing down, but before that, the second derivative was also positive. And if I ask you seriously, do you think we're going to go, remember that top line 2900? That's everything until the end of time, or at least for the next 4,000 years. What's the probability we will stay below there for the next 4,000 years? And it's probably less than 1%, okay? Based on the emission rate we're at now and how we can soon turn this over. Remember, because otherwise, no more agriculture, no more steel, no more cement, no more energy, okay? So we will go above that number, and I think we will go above 550 as well, and maybe 600. All right, so let me talk a little bit about the analogy to smoking. This is a graph of smoking, males and females, males in black and females in red, from 1900 to 2005. We were a very smoking country in the 20th century. By the mid-60s, the average consumption of cigarettes for males was 225 packs a year, including the non-smokers. Most people smoked, at least half of them smoked. In the 1940s, 1950s, the medical community said, what is going on? What used to be an extremely rare cancer, lung cancer, is becoming a major killer. And so they began to suspect that smoking and lung cancer were linked. So much so that by 1964, the US Surgeon General was able to get a warning label on the packages of cigarettes, caution, cigarette smoking may be hazardous to your health. Barked a long public campaign, especially aimed at school children, to convince young people to stop smoking. And this is what happened to cigarette consumption among males. It started to plunge. This was bad news for the American tobacco industry, and they did what they had to do. They took their cigarettes to China, India, Eastern Europe. So what happened is that 25 years after that big public campaign, smoking deaths due to lung cancer started to decline, beginning to do so with females because they started later. There's no actual difference epidemiologically between male and female in your chance of getting lung cancer and dying. If it's not caught early enough, it's still a fatal disease. We now know that smoking increases the risk of lung cancer, half a pack a day, 25 times, coronary heart disease, stroke, 2 to 4 times. Okay, what does this have to do with climate change? Well, a couple things. The damage you've already done to your lungs from smoking for 20, 25 years may already start to trigger multiple mutations. The damage we have done in terms of the amount of carbon dioxide or carbon dioxide equivalent in the upper atmosphere, we don't know how long it will come to equilibrium. There's large uncertainties in that. It could take 50 years, it could take 150 years, but somewhere in the scale of a century. The risks of secondary smoke it's everything about secondary smoke. We emit carbon dioxide today, but the real most profound effects won't be felt by us, any of you, the younger people beginning to be with you in your old age, your children, your grandchildren. So as I go around and give talks, what I'm finding is most of the attitude, if I had to kind of paraphrase it, would be, I really enjoy cigarettes. I don't want to give up the habit. It relaxes me. What happens to great-grandchildren halfway around the world I'll never see? Not my problem. And why should I give up this? And so if you ask, should you give up 0.5% of the GDP of a country to decrease carbon emission? The answer has been profoundly no way. Because the leaders of this country and other countries mostly say, nah, our voters won't go for it. So that's where we are. And now you say, but you're going to run out of oil and gas. And so when that happens, it self-corrects because it gets, as you begin to run out, it gets more expensive and the market will come to the rescue. So here's a favorite quote of mine, and it says, this person said, the Stone Age came to an end, but not for lack of stones. And the Oil Age will end, but not for lack of oil. It was said by Sheikh Yamani, a former Saudi oil minister. Now, that's not why he's the former Saudi oil minister. What he really meant, I believe, is that when you transition from something that's widely used to something new, it's because you found something better. So when you find something better, going from the Stone Age to the Metal Age, you don't go around and look at all the stones and tears come out of your eyes and say, look at those stranded assets. Right? You found something better. If you haven't found something better, they are stranded assets. So in this transition to better solutions, there's the flip side of this. And if you don't find a better solution, which includes the economics, intimately includes the economics, the oil and the gas and the coal will come out of the ground because it's wealth in the ground. And no country is really willing to say, we're going to leave billions and billions of dollars in the ground just because of something might happen 50 years from today. Okay? You know, I wish they would, but so far they're not worried enough. They should, by the way, think that. All right, let's talk about some good news, science and technology, and it can become the low-cost option. I really mean that. We have to find something better, a better solution, a lower-cost solution. The best low-cost solution, of course, is energy efficiency, and I mean in everything. I mean in buildings and cities and transportation, industrial processes everywhere. You can start humbly and lowly with appliances, as did California in the middle 1970s. This is from a paper I wrote with some colleagues of the cost of owning and operating appliances, refrigerators, room or central air conditioning, or clothes washers. The blue is the cost of ownership, which includes the purchase price and the cost of energy average over the United States. Refrigerators, we took a standard model that exists over a long period of time, or their equivalent, let's say above freezer 18 cubic foot refrigerator. The arrows, starting with the dashed arrows, are efficiency standards beginning in California. The solid arrows are efficiency standards in the federal government, which said that below a certain efficiency, you cannot sell this refrigerator in the US market. The red is the purchase price. What's plotted is on both on log scales is on the x-axis is how many shipments of refrigerators or air conditioners. And why we're applying a log scale is if you see a straight line, you see when you double the number of refrigerators produced and shipped, the cost of manufacturing or operation goes down by a certain fraction, let's say 10% per doubling of units shipped. That is called a learning curve. Again, no fundamental physics reason why technologies follow learning curves, but they do. Moore's law is a special case of a type of learning curve. And so what we found is that when standards came in, because you save energy, you save energy costs, the cost of ownership goes down, not a surprise. What was a surprise is that when efficiency standards came in, the purchase price went down. We were excited about this. We submitted the paper to Science Magazine. It actually went out for review. And it was reviewed by economists, and one reviewer said, this is amazing. This is totally unexpected, fascinating. The other two reviewers said, it doesn't matter what these people say, the economists are not going to believe it, which then told me, ooh, economists are not physicists. This is data. And reams and reams of data in the supplementary thing that you can dice and slice any way you want. Okay, so So it's called a market failure. Why would any manufacturer build a less efficient device if you can build something more efficient that costs less money? Because there's no incentive to go back to the drawing board. And so, anyway, whatever happened, it happened. The amount of energy saved was enormous. Refrigerator costs declined 28% for each doubling of production. And if you extrapolate the amount of energy used in refrigerators of the older technology, it's equivalent to 67 gigawatts worth of nuclear reactors, 6.7 nuclear reactors working 24/7. That of energy you saved on just refrigerators. That's a lot. Or all the coal plants in Ohio. You can choose your... refrigerators are a few percent of the electricity used in the United States. It's a big deal. And so... I'm a professor, so here's a surprise quiz. How many free market economists does it take to change a light bulb? Okay. Answer, none. If the light bulb needed changing, the free market would have done it. This is a religion I've discovered in my last decade of my life. Anyway, airplanes have become more fuel efficient. I'm going to skip that and just tell you, it's another surprise quiz. I'm going to tell you about airplanes. Most people think these airplanes look kind of the same. On the lower right is the 707, Boeing's first successful jet airplane. And the upper left is a Boeing 787. It has two engines instead of four, but hey, it looks the same. Well, they're the same except for one thing. The per passenger mile, the 787, which flies within 5% or 2% of the same speed as the 707, uses only 18% of the fuel as the 707. Okay, that's pretty good. It's instead of, 20 miles a gallon, you're getting over 100 miles a gallon. Instead of, be precise, instead of 18 miles a gallon, you're getting 100 miles a gallon. Talking about airplanes, the long-range airplane, probably popular long-range airplane is a Boeing 777. And what does that have in common with a barred-tailed godwit? You don't know what a barred-tailed godwit is. It's a little bird. It's about this big. And the thing they have in common is both the airplane and the bird can fly nonstop 1,100 kilometers. This bird spends its summers in Alaska and then wants summer, and so it migrates to New Zealand. Some of them stop off in China for refueling. Others fly over Hawaii but don't stop there. They use it as a navigation post and continue nonstop to New Zealand. When both bird and plane land, they weigh half of what they used to weigh because half of their weight in takeoff was fuel. Jet fuel, body fat. And they both have good autopilots. So airplanes require high density fuel, very high energy density fuel. And that's why we use jet fuel. And that's why live mobile platforms, use body fat. We carry our energy in body fat, not carbohydrates. It's very high density stuff. Let's talk about wind and solar energy. The United States, Canada, Mexico have tremendous wind energy. Depending on how high you go, these are for 90-foot, estimates for 90-foot hub heights and turbines. Technology is getting better. The hub height is going higher. These are very high hubs being installed. 164 meters, over 1.5 soccer fields tall. The blades are so big now they can't be shipped by truck or by train because of the turns in the railroad, they're too sharp. So they're being assembled in place, but it turns out that assembling them and making them reliable is cheaper if you go bigger. The ones offshore are even bigger. They're now 6 megawatt turbines are the standard offshore. Siemens is developing 8 megawatt standards. The size of this is also pretty big. This one's 154-meter diameter blades. The Wright brothers' first flight was 36 meters. And it's bigger, it's twice as big as an Airbus 380, the wingspan of the turbines. So they're making improvements. Price are going down, solar price are plunging. This is a solar map, fantastic solar resources. The great news is the price of solar and the price of wind are really going down, and it's hard to, you can make a rough estimate of what the price would be in a country like the United States that subsidizes solar or wind. There's a production tax credit for wind, and there's an investment tax credit for solar. But in other countries, they are now doing what's called reverse auction. Let's say you're in Mexico or Saudi Arabia or Peru, and you say, I will sign a contract with any developer who wants to put up a solar or wind farm, in this case it's solar, and I will buy your electricity, and we'll agree on the rate for the next 20 years. You bid what it is, you include the profit, we're not going to give you free land, we're not going to subsidize it, but do your best. And between 2013, 2014, 15, and 16, the bids have gone lower and lower, and now they're coming in at 4 to 3 cents a kilowatt hour, including the profit of the developer, no subsidy. What's the price of natural gas in the very, very low prices of natural gas? Let's say it's $4 a million BTU, which would be very historically low in the United States for the next 50 years. It would, it would be 5 cents a kilowatt hour. So solar at this level is cheaper. Wind is coming in at 3 cents a kilowatt hour, again, without subsidy. So this is very, very good news. These are much, much lower than a new coal plant with SOx and NOx scrubbers and with mercury in particulate matter. So coal in the United States is out of the picture. Natural gas, because it is the cheapest, one of the cheapest in the world, and wind and solar are better. All good news. And so I see the renewable and wind and solar getting, it's already pushing on 3 cents, but in the coming decade or so, getting in large areas of the world, 3 cents, and making a profit, 8% profit is IRRs of the investors that they want. And by 2035, conservatively by 2040, maybe 2 cents a kilowatt hour for wholesale electricity. Okay, less than one half of what it is today. Great. However, there's a world of difference between putting in wind energy at 5 or 10% of the entire electricity supply and going to 40 or 50%, and similarly with solar. Even worse with solar, because you're only capturing energy for about a quarter of the day. So as you go to these intermittent resources, you need a much more sophisticated electrical system. You need enhanced transmission to port energy from longer distances where the sun is shining or the wind is blowing. And ultimately, you would need energy storage. But energy storage can be day-night savings or maybe for a few days. But in the near-term future, meaning the first half of the century, it's not going to be seasonal storage. It won't be one-month storage. No one has on the drawing boards batteries that can make economically store things for a few months. So you still need energy on demand during this transition time. Now, transmission is a big deal. This is a wind factory locations in China. The good news is the wind is great where there are very few people. It's just like in the United States, from North Dakota down to Texas. Not many people, lots of great wind. So it's cheap land, and the farmers in America are only happy to be paid tens of thousands of dollars a year to have a turbine near them. So that's the good news, but the bad news is the population centers are on the east. So what China is doing is building very high voltage, long distance transmission lines. They're building some of the highest voltage lines in the world by far. They're the world leader. They've just started to build a 1.1 megavolt DC line, which is much more efficient than a megavolt AC line. And they can move electricity 3,200 kilometers and lose only 5% of the energy or the power. And there's no line in the United States that even comes close. This is their network that they're building up very rapidly. Let me just say that the transformers are big. The voltages are high. Those are people. they're normal-sized people. So this is a Siemens transformer, 800 kilovolts. Now you compare the map I showed in China to the one in the United States, and here we go. At the last DC line, 1989. We do not ship electricity across the country, even though the sun is best in the southwest, and there's a three-hour time difference, so you can port energy to the eastern seaboard. Makes a lot of sense, really cheap, clean. And the east electricity, New York metropolitan area, is very, very expensive. So those are connecting hydroelectric facilities, but that's the last DC line we did. Because if you're, let's say, in the PJM area, this is Pennsylvania, you know, New York, New Jersey, Maryland, you don't want cheap energy coming from wind in the Midwest, because if cheap energy comes into your area, the money you invested to build electricity generating plants become a stranded asset. So you actually don't want the lowest cost electricity for your customer. You want the highest profit for yourself. Now, I know you would say to yourself, I'm shocked, there's gambling here, I'm shocked. To use the Casablanca line, but you know, money talks. Another crazy thing, New England is the highest cost electricity. Canada wants to sell them hydroelectric power. It's as clean as it gets. Got lots of surplus hydroelectric power. That's, by the way, energy on demand. It's great, right? The dam is your storage mechanism, but they don't want it because it's too cheap. And so how do you fight against that? Well, you convince people that they don't want overhead lines near their summer home in New Hampshire and Vermont. And it works. Okay, so there are resistance mechanisms that seem to work. We need a much more modern grid. These many, many pieces, you know, you're generating from rooftops, you're generating from intermittent renewables, you're generating halfway across the country. So you need a transmission line and distribution and transmission system that can automatically deal with this. It cannot be manual. And so you need lots of instrumentation, and it has to be automatic. And even better than that, you will need to use what we call now machine learning and massive data sets, so you have much better predictive power on what the weather is going to do, what the energy demands are going to do. And here's a picture of Google Alphabet Go beating one of the top Go players in the world. Considered a much harder game than chess. It's much more pattern recognition. And so now machines can do a better job at playing chess, playing Go. They are doing a better job of face pattern recognition in lots of photographs and videos. They are doing a better job at failure prediction, picking up lots of little data from massive turbines or commercial jet airlines, so you don't have catastrophic failure, you can have a maintenance change. And English translation, if you're in a foreign country, you push Google Translate, that's a machine that translates. And it's now not perfect, but it's not bad. And pretty soon, I think there will be artificial intelligence machine learning that can understand accents and can real-time transcribe that into a foreign language, so simultaneous translators will not be needed. That same sort of technology for autonomous driving, for medical diagnostics, will be needed for the grid, but it's here. And so that's a very exciting opportunity. I'm quickly going down the list of things, energy storage. Here's one of my favorite forms of energy storage. When the wind blows, you store the energy by pumping the water out of the ground and putting it a little higher. We used to know about this technology. It's time to relearn some of this. When there's excess nighttime electricity and you're in a hot, sweaty area, cool a bunch of water and use it for air conditioning the next day. When I was Secretary of Energy, I was touring around Texas and said, you know, you're giving away, you know, because of all your wind turbines, you're actually paying people to take your electricity to get the production tax credit. Why don't you use the electricity to cool big tanks of water to use for air conditioning? I'm happy to report that it's being done. Right? You don't have to waste the energy. And Stanford University just put in a new cogen plant where they have two big water tanks to buy nighttime electricity to chill the water to use in their chilled water system to air condition the buildings. It works. It's economical. It's a low-cost solution. And it's a form of a battery. Normal batteries, progress is being made. This is Professor Yishui, Materials Science Department. That arrow is the standard energy density of anodes of a carbon battery. He's done a lot of pioneering research in making silicon anodes, and the company he founded is in the process of trying to commercialize this, as are other companies. And then finally, if you go to pure metal lithium, so instead of lithium in surrounding silicon or lithium embedded in carbon, you have pure metal, you can get energy densities that are maybe five times as high density. And so I've begun to work over the last 3 years with Professor Shui with on the lithium metal anodes. And we don't have the commercial battery yet. I don't know if we'll get there, but I'm hoping someone will. Because if you have a battery of this type and it can last 15 years and works in cold and doesn't auto-destruct in warm or hot, you can transform transportation. Cost of batteries is going down. This is the real cost on the left-hand side, 2005 to 2030. Anything the left of that others, well, you can see where the real data ends. And that circle in green is the Tesla Gigafactory projection, where I allotted for the Elon Musk factor. I raised the cost and moved the year out by 1 year. But that's just empirical. No fundamental theory involved. But even so, startlingly good news that the cost of batteries is going down faster than we had hoped for. The final challenge to get to full sustainability around the world is you have to get chemical storage, liquid hydrocarbon room temperature storage. That means you take cheap, clean electricity and you split water into hydrogen and oxygen. You take clean, cheap electricity and you turn it to carbon dioxide and you begin to assemble hydrocarbons. Now, once you have a hydrocarbon that stores at room temperature, you can ship it all around the world. You can store it on your shore. We have 1 year of petroleum supplies on our shore. Typically, we have a half a year, but there's an oil glut, so we have a year. And which means you have energy security. All the developed countries have about a half a year of oil on their own shores. And so that means you want to grab carbon dioxide from all the power plants, cement plants, steel plants, and from the atmosphere. And you want to recycle that carbon dioxide, and you want to use clean carbon-free energy to make those liquid hydrocarbons. What's the price you need? Well, if it's transportation, you need hydrogen at $1.50 a kilogram. But today, it's $5 a kilogram with today's technologies. The good news is electricity will be at least twice as cheap. So it's not so crazy. And so if you assume that electricity is 2 cents a kilowatt hour and you can make the control of the capital expenses, then it's possible to use clean energy sources to make liquid hydrocarbons. Once you have that, then we don't need nuclear, we don't need coal, we don't need natural gas. It all becomes self-sustaining. And you have to capture the carbon dioxide out of the air, because if we go to 600, 650, 700, we're not looking at 2 degrees, or we're looking 3 or 4. That would be very, very tragic. I don't know what exactly would happen. So, and we have only a couple hundred years to fix it, to get it out. And so that's another technology. Now that's going to cost at least $100 a ton to get it out of the atmosphere, and then to sequester it somewhere safely, to mineralize it, to do something with it, or to recycle it into a carbon-based fuel, which is also, once you recycle it, then it becomes, from air to this and recycle, it becomes. So let me end by reminding you of one of my favorite pictures. It's called Earthrise. It was taken in the Apollo 8 mission that first orbited the moon. And the astronaut who took this picture said, "We came all this way to explore the moon. And the most important thing is we discovered the Earth." Now, if you look at this picture, the moon is not a good place to live. There's no air there. There's no water there. From this vantage point, the Earth looks very inviting. And there's nowhere else to go. So since 1968, very strong evidence that the climate is changing, very strong evidence that it's due to humans, in large part. And so we got to fix it, because we'll end up where we're heading if we don't. Thank you.
Let me join me again in thanking Secretary Chu, and what a wonderful talk, eh? So there are some wireless mics that will be distributed. We'll have time for a few questions. And then from there, we'll be moving towards the levering for a reception. Questions, please.
Hi, Professor. How do you feel about the future of bacterial engineering for carbon capture?
I think that is a real possibility. I don't know to what extent, you know, bacteria, algae, things of that nature have been talked about. There are issues with some of this. I think there's a lot of engineering of bacteria. There was a first euphoria in around 2006, 5, 6, 7, where you could use bacteria or versions of yeast and other microbes to take cellulose and turn into drop-in ready fuel, and you begin with taking glucose and turn it into drop-in ready fuels. Those things have not been as, it's still a good approach, but it is not commercially viable yet. And so the companies that have survived are trying to make higher value products. Plants are actually better at capturing carbon dioxide, trees and crops. Going to more sustainable agriculture is a first big deal that can be done economically. And it's just changing traditions, not wildly new technology, lower tillage things. Not over-fertilizing, you know, the fertilized nitrogen phosphorus fertilizers, you actually, you know, the plants pick up most of it. You do 10% fertilization more, and 9% of it becomes N2O. It's really nonlinear. It's like when the plant doesn't want them anymore, the environment picks it up. Things like that are really easy to change, but you need a public awareness of, and then the fertilizer runoff is also not good. So there are many, many other things you can do of agriculture's geoengineering, serious geoengineering, but improving that agricultural practices worldwide is a very big deal. 30% of greenhouse gas is coming from agriculture. It's a very big deal. So, but certainly microbial modifications are on the books as a possible way of many, many things.
Maybe two more questions and then we'll move on.
Professor, do you mind telling me your comments about fracking and shale on
sure.
the environment?
Okay, so there have been incidents in fracking and shale gas, and it's actually the oil thereafter. The rise in the oil glut is due to fracking of rock for oil. So there have been environmental mishaps, to be sure. I think the industry is finally beginning to admit this. And the question is, how bad is it? And and is it, it's going to be anything you could done about it, or you just simply don't use the resource. I personally think if one looks at most of the incidents that have occurred, the president asked the Department of Energy to look into this, not because we regulate federal land use, but because we're a science organization, and he felt we would do a less political tainted job about looking at what technologies were available and what would. So I appointed a committee, and we issued a report, which essentially said that most of it was due to sloppy drilling practices that are completely avoidable. I mean, Macondo was avoidable. ExxonMobil Valdez was avoidable. And so these are avoidable. And so there are things you can do to avoid it. I personally think that natural gas can be a transition fuel, is a transition fuel, but it's not like our energy problem is over. We got to get off natural gas by mid-century or towards the end of the century. It's less polluting than coal, but it still emits a lot of carbon dioxide. And whatever natural gas is left, you have to capture. And so for that reason, I think that you want to make fracking practices better and have responsible regulation and enforcement. And when people aren't, you know, the big fear is the small companies who aren't big enough to sustain lawsuits. They just go belly up. They don't even go through Chapter 11. They leave country. A small company can do billions of dollars of damage. A small company can do millions. And so that's a real issue. We still drive cars and we still fly airplanes. And so I'm of the ilk that we should improve the safety and really protect the environment. It's not a clear-cut thing. There's some benefits to having natural gas, at least for the next couple of decades. So that's my opinion on that. Try to get the industry to move in the right direction. Regulation will push them. Trying to get them to move in the right direction by getting insurance companies to say, if you do the right things and you can have an independent entity say you're doing the right things, the insurance on your drilling will go down. So an economic incentive. We'll see what happens. One more comment on fracking. There's a lot of concerns about the earthquakes in Oklahoma. They are due to the oil and gas industry. There's no doubt about that. But it's sometimes confused with fracking. The earthquakes induced by the oil and gas industry have to do with conventional oil drilling and gas drilling. And then you get flowback water. And they take the water, and it's toxic mining water. It's got all sorts of horrible things in it. And they inject it back into the ground. They can't put in sewage treatment plants because they're not designed to take out heavy toxic metals. And they over-injected. And so they over-injected too much, and the earthquake went way up. And so they're backing off the injection. You have to spread it out more. But those are other issues and that have to be dealt with. I take some middle view only because I'm worried in the long term about carbon dioxide. But in the end, I think you've got, and if they continue to make terrible mistakes, sadly, you get the regulation you deserve. You just hope it doesn't have to always end up that way.
Right. One last question, please. Yeah.
Along with the methane, along with the CO2, the methane too is a greenhouse gas. Is there any advancement in understanding the challenges or finding new solutions on the emissions of methane?
Well, yes. So the methane, there are some fugitive emissions in fracking. I personally think to, again, sloppy drilling habits, and one other thing that's totally preventable, as you go down, the typical fracking pad, you go down and you go horizontally. So you're going down typically 4,000 feet and you're going horizontally. And then you're extracting. As you go down, you may go into a minor fossil play that makes no economic sense to recover. Now as you go down, you drill a wall. There's this dirt. You put a steel case. You have to put a steel case from certain, because a lot of the freshwater aquifers are there, so you're required to put a steel case and cement around the casing so you don't leak. There is no federal regulation that says you have to steel case all the way down. So beyond the first 150 feet or so, they say, okay, you don't need a steel casing. Now, as you go through, now if you go deep water drilling, totally different, you have to do a double steel casing all the way down and cement. Because if you have a blowout in 1 mile deep leaking on seafloor, it's a catastrophe. So there's a regulation that demands that. There's no regulation that says you shouldn't case all the way down. There should be, I think, in my opinion, but there's an intermediate step, which we have the technology that won't cost much money at all. As you drill down, there's drilling mud that comes back up, and so it's drilling mud and it brings the debris. The mud is artificial mud, it gets recycled. What they now do is they test for hydrogen sulfide. They don't test for methane because it's not deemed dangerous. They don't want an explosion. It's not a high enough concentration. But it could very well be that when you go through this mire play and you don't have a steel case with cement backfilling, you don't plug up the hole, and so the gas leaks up to the top couple hundred feet where it canoes to the surface. That's just sound, that's a simple regulation that's really cheap. A very small fraction of the cost of recovery. So there are things like that I think should be put in practice quickly. Okay, now eventually, and there's some states that already demand you have full casing and cementing all the way down. Believe it or not, West Virginia is one of those states. Okay, so in the end, and then you can get rid of the fugitive emissions like that. The other stuff is just sloppy stuff. Most of the gas, methane, comes from agriculture, either from rotting stuff buried or from the front and back end of cows. That's actually significant. So people are looking into how to modify the cow or the feed so that they're more socially presentable. But also old pipelines, but we have infrared sensors and drones that can find leaks in pipes and pipelines across, and also in cities. So all the fugitive emissions that are coming from 50, 80-year-old gas pipelines or new pipelines that leak, and agriculture is a big deal. Agriculture is the biggest emitter, mostly beef.
Okay. Well, let's thank our speaker one more time. So the Wenk lecture basically moves around between departments of the WSC, and each year a different department organizes the lectures. And this year, we in the Electrical and Computer Engineering had the pleasure of doing so. And we have a little gift for you, to say thank you for taking the time. I know you have a very busy schedule, for coming out and telling us all these great things. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
So we're going to whisk Secretary Chu over to Levering. We'll try not to spend too much time here so we can have some more time for some more questions and so on at Levering. Thank you so much for coming. Appreciate it.